Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. You mean to wish me a good morning, or do you mean that it is a good morning whether I want it or not?
Please go away. Let me sleep for the love of God.
Ben Malzie, howdy, partners.
Howdy.
Pull up a chair, get some whiskey in here. Hey, we've got to prove we've got whiskey. We've got to chink that. Yeah, Ben, just pretend Ben's got one.
There we go. The whole bottle. Calm down, Ben.
I'm dooted up, egg sucking gutter track.
Well, I was going to say, if you feel like busting out a rendition of My Little Buttercup, just give me fair warning because I'll join in, mate. Has the sweetest smile. I could have even sort of come in with Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head as a nice little intro, but I chose some tasty saloon music. Do you feel like you're in the mood, Ben?
Well, we didn't hear the saloon music, so no.
Fourth wall?
Exactly.
Fourth wall?
He does it to me every week. What? I'm supposed to wheel in a fucking piano and start. And
actually, I could envision that right now. you should.
Here's some trivia for you. Those saloon-style pianos are called tack pianos. Did you know that? They're ordinary upright pianos, and they've got thumbtacks or nails stuck to them to distort the sound.
Oh, really?
That's why they sound punchy and tinny when they do that.
I just like them when you go into like Sovereign Hill and stuff, and they've got them, and you push one button and it all moves, but no one's actually playing it.
So there you go. Some useless information to get us started. Welcome back, Malzie.
Thank you.
It's always great to have you on the show. Oh,
it's good to be here, and always.
You came dressed in theme.
I did. I almost wasn't here, but I themed it up and I got here.
Amazing. Good Movie Monday. Hello, everybody. Welcome to another week. We are the weekly podcast dedicated to nerdy cinematic ramblings. My name is Glenn Cochran, and the gutless yellow pie slinger over there is Ben Howig. Hey, Ben, how are you?
I'm just curious, what useful information do you think this show imparts?
He continued on too quickly for me to go, there'll be much more of that to come.
Well, you literally, the banner of the show is nerdy cinematic ramblings. Like, there is nothing.
Well, this is...
Like, unless someone's going, like, entering a trivia competition, like, or a trivia night or something like that, there is, on your day-to-day life, there is nothing that we impart that's going to help anyone.
Lovers of movies would disagree. And again, once again, we do have Malzie at the desk from the Melbourne Horror Film Society. We're going to do things a little bit differently this week, Malzie, because we normally reserve your episodes for horror themes.
Yes.
But this week, if they haven't guessed already, we're switching up the themes to westerns. And that's simply because we got offered the opportunity to interview Thomas Jane and Richard Gray. They are the two guys involved with the new movie Murder at Yellowstone City. Richard Gray's the director. Thomas Jane's one of the stars. And I'm going to be talking to them a little bit about that. So it's not horror specific, but that's not to say there aren't horror westerns.
No, there's actually quite a tie between the two.
Let's drop some of those a bit later in the show and have a conversation about them. But let's also stay with horror for a moment because, as I said, you're from the Horror Film Society. Last couple of screenings, we had Tucker versus Dale, Dale versus
Tucker,
Evil, whichever way you want to cut it.
Tucker,
I mean,
and Dale.
Yeah,
Evil,
I mean, whichever way you put their names, they're versing, aren't they?
Yeah.
And you almost screened The Hand.
We almost screened, but it kind of works out well because now we had to, so it was meant to be last Tuesday night, but we've had to postpone it to tomorrow night. So you've got a chance to come along. So The Hand tomorrow night, but if you miss that, then the actual July screening will be Idle Hands on Tuesday, July 26th, and they're at Long Play in Fitzroy North.
Fantastic. And what's the website?
MelbourneHorrorFilmSociety.org. And we are also on all the socials, Melbourne Horror. And we also have a Discord channel. And this month we're going to be going back to lockdown time, but not officially. But during lockdown we started doing online watch parties and we're going to just randomly do another one of those this month at some point. Drag Me to Hell.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, so...
And how do you get onto this?
What is Discord? And
why can't I just get on without having to talk to anyone?
And I mean, that's the kind of thing your dad says when he's behind the TV. He goes, what is Discord?
All you have to do is
he's nuts.
Send us a message on any of our platforms, Facebook, I know you follow us on all of them, so you know how to press the message button. And all you have to do is say, hey, guys, can I please get a link to your Discord channel? And we'll send you the link and bang, you're in. And the community's great and we do little things
so
like that.
So you've got to invest a little bit of energy in this, Ben. That's why you're not on it.
The tiniest of bits of energy.
To a degree, I understand that maybe you don't want to just have the link on the page so you can just click it without having to talk to anyone.
And it also changes as well.
Oh, does it? It's not a constant link?
It's not, no. Sorry.
For that particular session, it's not a...
No, I think it's just like every 7 days it updates.
It updates. Yeah.
It's just a Discord thing. It's a Discord thing, Ben.
I'm so old.
To know
all you got to say is Discord Inferno and Ben's there.
Yeah.
I reckon
we're doing disco westerns. I'm down.
Oh, fuck, yes. We should write one of those. We're pretty much off and running, but no episode of Good Movie Monday could be complete without the weekly shenanigans from our troupe. So coming up, we do have Guillermo Troncoso from Screen Realm, which is an online entertainment magazine that's been offline for the last few weeks. So it'll be interesting to see where they're at. And then also we have the guys from Kentucky Bonehead Weekly podcast. That is Joe Lewis, Chad Jennings, and James Thomas. They're going to talk about Western movies as well. They're from where the West is. Like,
yeah.
They are.
They are the Kentuckians.
Smack bang in the middle of it all. So it'll be interesting to see how they go.
One's not a Kentuckian anymore, is he? Or are they all still Kentuckians?
If you're born and bred there.
Or is one like a Missourian? Or
expat, let's just say that.
Yeah.
And then, of course, there's this bloke who comes to us from the same place Ben does, which is Monster Pictures and Monster Fest. Oh. This guy loves his... What were you
going
to say?
I thought you were going somewhere different with
that. goes without saying, this guy loves his physical entertainment. And by physical entertainment, I mean 4K, Blu-ray, not so much DVD.
Filthy DVD. SD, gross.
Let's not talk about VHS and all the others, but in other words, movies you can touch.
Hey, this is Jarrett, and welcome to PE Class. It's a huge week of releases this week, and as such, as always, I'm only going to give you the highlights. So first up, I'm going to start with Roadshow, and from the Warner catalogue, they're releasing the third installment in the Fantastic Beasts franchise, The Secrets of Dumbledore. They're releasing this one on 4K, Blu-ray, and DVD. Now, the 4K and Blu-ray come with 12 featurettes and deleted scenes as special features. And also, the 4K Ultra HD has Dolby fucking Atmos. Also from Roadshow, from the Rialto catalogue, is the film Hatching. If you haven't seen this one, I advise checking it out. We played it at MonsterFest Weekend recently, and it was pretty much a crowd favourite. However, this one's only getting a DVD release. Then also out from Roadshow is The Drover's Wife, the Australian film. They're giving it a Blu-ray and DVD release. Next up is Indicator, and they're digging deep, deep into the Hollywood vaults to unleash a bunch of classics on Blu-ray, most of which are making their Blu-ray debut, both locally and globally. The titles include A Night to Remember, Barabbas, The Long Ships, Julius Caesar, Damn the Defiant, and The Nelson Affair. Then we're going to dig right into the really good stuff. Umbrella Entertainment have a slate of huge releases this week, and they're all pure gold. First up is Ghoulies 1 and 2. They're releasing it in a 2-disc Blu-ray double pack. And this isn't simply a rehash of the old Glass Doll release. No, they've loaded it with all that content and much more, including 2 TV cuts of the first film. Not to mention, it's got an attractive slipcover that pays homage to the original Roadshow home video VHS release. Next up is Dead Kids hitting Blu-ray. This is joining the Ozploitation Classics line, and again, this isn't simply a port of the out-of-print Glass Doll or Seven release. This edition has even more special feature content, including previously unreleased deleted scenes, and as always, it comes with an attractive slipcover, and it actually has the original theatrical key artwork, which was also present on the old VHS release too. It's great artwork, arguably better than the movie itself. Then next up from Umbrella, they've got Hobo with a Shotgun. It's hitting Blu-ray, and again, not a rehash of the old Transmission Films release that came out on DVD and Blu-ray some time ago. No, this one's got all the special features as well as new art, and as always the case with a Beyond Genres release, it's got a slipcover on it too. Then last up from Umbrella is The Love Witch. This is finally making its local home entertainment debut. And Annabella's Festival, darling, isn't coming out vanilla. It's coming out loaded with special features, a megaton of special features, if you will. And it also includes Biller's previous film, Viva, as an added bonus on the limited edition second disc. So it's been a hell of a week for releases. What are you going to pick up? I'm curious to know. Hit us up on the socials and tell us. Anyway, that's it for me for this week. So until next time, stay physical.
What a great week of releases, Ben. And one movie that he didn't mention, which is a Western that's getting released, is Ghosts of the Ozark. With can't go wrong with Tim Blake Nelson and David Arquette and Angela Bettis.
No.
I don't know.
No.
We are doing a Western.
I prefer them to be in a wrestling movie. Ready to Rumble 2.
And, of course, we have The Drover's Wife, The Legend of Molly Johnson. That's an Aussie one that's quite interesting, set in Victoria's high country. It's a Western week because then, again, Murder at Yellowstone City is hitting home entertainment this week. But most importantly, Ben, let's talk about the non-Western related release of Ghoulies 1 and 2.
It's news to me that that's coming out this week.
Do you want to tell us a little about it?
Well, it's got Ghoulies 1 and 2.
Don't worry, Jared did most of the talking for you.
Did he mention it all?
Honestly, this is a bit of a passion project for you.
Yeah, we did it. We did it with the, we used the original Roadshow VHS artwork as the inspiration for the cover art on the two. We included some never before seen TV cuts of the film.
Amazing.
Of the first Ghoulies. Cool. And got some great interviews with Phil Fondacaro, my favourite, from Ghoulies 2, and Ken J. Hall for Ghoulies and Ghoulies 2, and he is one of the creators of Puppet Masters, as well as fun that he worked on Ghoulies. He also created the Puppet Masters with Charlie Band.
It's fair to say it's the most comprehensive release of Ghoulies 1 and 2 yet.
Yeah, let's say that.
I mean, he's not talking up his product much, is he?
I mean, look at it. Look at.
Is that fair?
I suppose it is.
After listening to that,
I suppose it is. Like, there's a couple of things that we didn't I wanted to include that we didn't get to include, that would have really upped it.
Yep.
But it's different.
But
it's
not
different
everyone
from
can
any
get
other
hold of
release.
Ghoulies 4. That's the problem, right?
Yeah. Yeah. No Ghoulies. It would have been great to include Ghoulies 3 and 4. Especially, like, Ghoulies 3 is the one that I really remember as a kid.
I got, what, is it Kevin McCarthy in that one?
He put me on the spot. All I remember is that it's, they go to college.
They do.
It's the college one.
And there's three Ghoulies
and
in the
toilet. And on the cover, there's lots of girls in their underwear. Because the Ghoulies go on like a panty raid. But really, it's actually...
Remembering the important details, yeah. Always.
Oh, now we're interested. All right. Well, I thought you might want to plug that one. Clearly, you don't.
you actually, like, Umbrella, do not tell me when these things are coming out.
Fair enough.
So I had no idea until you sprung it on me that it was actually... is
surprise!
Available. They have still not sent me my a copy of it yet.
Well, you're welcome. I'm keeping you up to speed, mate. I'm feeling very uncomfortable about this part of the show. Yeah. Let's move on to recommendations. But before we do, let's talk about these subgenres. There's no shortage of Western movies to talk about, but you've got the spaghetti Western, obviously. Mm-hmm. In Australia, you've got the meat pie Western. You mentioned last week the kraut Western. It got me interested in all these cuisines of Westerns around the world, and there's heaps of them.
I've never heard the term meat pie Western before.
Yeah, it is a term used. There's a Wikipedia entry for it with all the listings of what is considered a meat pie Western. It's essentially an Aussie Western. But go around the world, and in Asia, you've got the ramen Westerns, which is a thing.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
Where you got a curry Western, which is obviously, you know, Indian. What else was there? Acid Westerns. It's not a food, but you can consume it, and that's sort of the El Topos and the dead man type of Westerns. Yeah. What other one? Oh, I love this one. From Hungary, you've got the goulash Westerns.
I had no idea that there were any Hungarian Westerns.
So, I mean, I want to say... useful information, but...
or rambling.
No, interesting. Interesting information.
Yeah.
Just not useful. How many people, you know, they're going to go to work on... they're going to go to work after listening to the show on Monday morning. Trying to keep that fourth wall up.
There's water coolers to talk around and, you know...
Yeah, they're going to be like, hey, check out that... What do you guys think about Hungarian goulash Westerns?
I feel like you should really get behind the show, Ben. But, you know, my favourite type of Western are those, they're called Northerns, and they're the Alaskan / Canadian Westerns, which are much more your Revenants and Yukon type of movies.
Yeah, Northwest Mounted Police and stuff like that.
Yeah, I love a good Northern. But I've never called it a Northern. It's just, to me, it's always like a wilderness Western.
Yeah.
But now we know what to call it.
I'm surprised that they don't have things like Southern. Like, so many Westerns are set in Texas, and it's not the West.
Yeah.
It's the South.
Yeah. It's so odd.
Yeah.
It's so odd to me. But anyway, so we've gone through those. Let's do some recommendations.
All right.
You're up first. I'm going to just take a guess. And is it the sexy meat pie Western, The Adventures of Eskimo Nell? Is that what you're going to talk about?
No, there's no... I like my Westerns with as little sex as possible.
Makes one of us.
It's all dirty.
I mean, it gets a bit dusty.
I don't think, actually, no, that's a lie. My second recommendation does have a lot of sex in it. I thought I would take this opportunity to go back and watch some classic Westerns that I have never seen.
Mm. Awesome.
Like the ones that everyone talks about as being the standard by which all other Westerns are measured. But for whatever reason, I haven't seen.
Many ways, that should be what the show's all about. We're just too lazy, haven't got enough time to actually do that every week.
Yeah.
It was a struggle. Like, I mean, hopefully no one that pays my wages listens to the show. Because otherwise they'll know that I spent the whole day just watching.
He offers this freely. But,
you know, I mean... And by that, I mean, it's Saturday, so it's fine.
Yeah. It's true. It's a bit much to expect.
Yeah. I reply to emails on my phone.
How many fourth walls can this guy break on one show?
Seriously.
Saturday on Good Movie Monday.
I'm really trying to get behind the show. It's just not working for me this week. But then I'm the only one not hammered.
Or dressed up.
Yeah, or dressed up. Literally.
I'm dressed as a bartender, and Melzie's double denimed. Like.
And with cowboy boots.
With cowboy boots.
Yeah. It's all right. Lucky I'm here this week.
Yeah, I didn't know.
Bring up this side of the...
Yeah, lifted up this side of the table. I failed in every aspect of it.
No, not at all.
We'll get him a paper bag and he can rustle.
I can go shit in the bushes if you want. It's funny enough, aside from maybe the series Deadwood, I don't think... It's like how 2001 A Space Odyssey is the first movie ever to show someone flushing a toilet.
Yeah.
Deadwood's the first Western to ever show anyone actually going to take a shit. It's just something they didn't do, and you're like, they're all like, even this, the movie that I'm going to talk about is the John Ford classic Stagecoach.
Yeah.
The movie is...
We turn back around to that really
get back
quickly,
to it.
Yeah.
The movie is all about them going on this long Stagecoach journey. No one ever takes a shit. There's one scene where the two women on the Stagecoach drink some water. They're the only two who drink water. You're the only ones who drink, except for the doctor who's a drunk. No one drinks.
What is it? Do you remember that comedian in Australia, Ostentatious? Do you remember him?
Yeah.
He did that joke, you know, John Wayne saying, "All the world is a stage coach." And I thought it was the worst joke ever.
Well, it made it, like, this film was it was a film that made his career.
And Ostentatious?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. Without Stagecoach, Ostentatious wouldn't have a career.
I thought it was Australiana. Either way, Jesus. We're not here to talk about that. No. I'm doing what Ben does best, and that's to take away from his recommendation and talk about something else.
Yeah, that's fine. I wish
it's a Western trope. It's revenge.
I wish I knew more about Ostentatious, but aside from the frequent appearances on Roadshow VHS, tapes,
yes,
that, you know, I would see stomach's making a noise. I don't really know anything about, like, he was, I know he wore sunglasses.
He did.
On his stage, but I always thought he was always,
he was the poor man's Rodney Roode.
Yeah. He was, well, he was no Steady Eddie. He didn't have he wasn't on Hey Hey It's Saturday enough for me to have paid much attention to him. I apologize, Ostentatious, if you're listening to this. But this movie is made in 1939. It's been remade possibly more than any other Western. directed by John Ford. And he actually had to go to bat for John Wayne because the producer, who was putting up, I think, half of the financing, refused and actually wanted him to basically hide Gary Cooper and replace Claire Trevor with Marlene Dietrich. And said, look, you're not going to get the money if you don't put these two people in it.
Yeah, right.
And John Ford stuck to his guns and said, get stuffed. It's John Wayne or nothing. John Wayne got the part and then went on to become like a superstar.
So at that point in time, was John Wayne much more of a song and dance man? Like, what was the objection? No, what was the objection? Because, I mean, he wasn't always
famous. He just, yeah. No one knew who he was. Mm. He'd only done a few, you know, much smaller roles.
Okay, cool.
I remember there was, I did see one not too long ago with him, but he, like, and it was a Western, but it was like a modern Western, like people are on the train.
Yep. Oh, no, I think I know the one you're talking about.
Going out to like a dude ranch. He was like, it was like that kind of era stuff. But,
yep. Okay.
I mean, I feel bad because I haven't done much research on John Wayne, so I can't really talk with any kind of authority.
John Wayne's real name? Marion.
Marion. Yeah, Marion.
Well, I mean, they probably...
That was my trivia question for later in the show. Thank you, Glenn.
Revenge is a dish best served cold. Yeah. And the thing is, though, like, maybe they didn't want him in the film because he was billed as Marion.
Maybe that's it. He hadn't changed his name to John yet.
Put him on the bill with whatever the female lead is. It sounds like a lesbian film.
Which I fucking oath I would have watched that.
Oh, Eskimo Nell, here we go.
You know, because I think I'm not going to go there. just a slippery slope. So basically,
yeah. That's the tagline.
I feel bad because there is some Mexicans in this film.
Yes, I just snorted. Let's just put it out there,
guys. So basically...
The whiskey's working.
Getting back to Stagecoach, the film is literally about a bunch of people on a stagecoach trying to get to a town across the other side of this desert, I guess. On the other side, this, you know, three or four towns along. But... They're supposed to be getting escorted by the army, but the army have all pulled out because the Apaches are on the warpath, and everything's very dangerous. The Apaches do turn up, but there's probably only 20 of them.
Yeah,
but it's still a pretty harrowing scene. But the cast is pretty good, and shockingly, so it is John Wayne. John Wayne plays the Ringo Kid, who's actually under arrest for the majority of the film because he's out gunning for the men that killed his pa. Is Sam Peckinpah.
Sorry, we're going to get messages at midnight again. Yeah. Contesting out.
Proving it. And Claire Trevor chops up, George Bancroft, Donald Meek, but the surprise for me in it is that it has a younger John Carradine as the kind of, he's like a, he's a weird character because he's like a professional gambler, but he's also very concerned. My stomach is making so much noise. it's vibrating.
He's trying to reenact Blazing Saddles. Yeah, is what's happening. Yeah.
He felt bad that he didn't come in costume.
He's in character.
Yeah, yeah.
My stomach is local. I'm going to do my best Ruben impression later on and just puke all over you. Like you can't double denim without getting a bit of a bomb on you.
Stop in the show for a second to lay some context there.
Yeah.
Malzie's son spewed all over her this morning.
And what, he didn't spew all over me, he spewed in the toilet.
Ben's implying.
Yeah. It wasn't all over me. I had these clothes on. Hello.
Malzie, yeah. Go with it.
Oh, no, I'm going by the Facebook story that said this was my outfit until Ruben puked on it, and then you had a onesie on. I thought that was legit. I didn't realize that it was all in the aid of a good Facebook story.
That's not what I said. I was dressed like this for the day, like ready to go to work and everything, yeah. And then Ruben started vomiting, and my day, like,
I misread. I thought the reason I had a whole thing about you double denim, then you got and you he puked on you. Like
so,
you
took one look at it.
We're finding out some sort of weird fantasy here. This is what I envisioned.
Sorry to disappoint you. Read that story, yeah. But anyway, so John Carradine He's a gambler, but he's also very concerned with propriety. Mm. There's a real class struggle going on in this film, especially with the Claire Trevor character, who's like a prostitute, mm-hmm. who, despite being incredibly nice and helpful to everyone else on the stagecoach, is treated like a pariah by everyone except for John Wayne.
Gotcha.
But especially by John Carradine, who is, like, for me, I don't know about you guys, but the only things that I really know John Carradine for is from horror films, mm. where he's always played like almost like an Undertaker type yeah. kind of character.
He's the Peter Cushing, Peter Cushing. Like,
yeah. He's super creepy.
Yeah.
He's very attractive.
He's delightful.
He is great. He's got a great deep voice, and he's like a, you know, he's good with a gun. And there's actually like this movie, I guess maybe because of the time and maybe the Hays Code, it shies away from a lot of the violence. Like, they do cut away.
Yeah.
You do see a couple of people get shot by the Indians, or the Indians get shot. But otherwise, most of the gunshots are all done off camera and you just hear them. And it's always done in a pretty inventive way. But at one point in the film, when they're under attack and it looks like they're gonna lose,
mm.
John Carradine has one bullet left and he decides to use it on... there's a woman in the stagecoach with them that he's... he served under her father, who was a general in the army.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to use it on her, and he puts the gun to her head, and then he gets he gets shot and can't kill her. But it is a shocking moment for a 1939 yeah. Western.
Wow!
It is great, and I do really now want to go and watch there was a remake in the 60s. I think there's another remake in the 80s.
Well, interesting. I was scrolling through Tubi, which is an amazing mm. resource for classic westerns, right? And I'm scrolling through, and there's one called Return of Ringo. And now it clicks. It's a stagecoach film.
Yeah, right.
Like a quasi-sequel of some sort.
If only they were like Eulorium and sponsored us.
Oh, wouldn't that be amazing? We might have to...
Tubi. Yeah. I don't have COVID. That was a note, for you.
If you missed that.
Have some whiskey, mate. It helps.
Yeah. But anyway, stagecoach. Awesome. Check it out.
Melza, you're up.
Oh, I don't know if I can follow all of that now. The pressure's on. So I love horror. Mm-hmm. You know that? I love musicals. I used to be in musicals when I was younger. Love comedy. Anyway, mine is Cannibal, the musical.
Oh, amazing. Amazing.
So Trey Parker and Matt Stone, they made this when they were college students in 93. Apparently, they were trying to get it out there. It was rejected by every film festival.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Yep, and so they were just holding like little screenings of it and started to get some good word of mouth. Anyway, Troma ended up releasing it in 96. And then obviously when they got famous with South Park, it took off from there. So it's loosely based on the true story of Alfred Parker, who's the only person to be convicted of cannibalism in America. And it's actually like apparently they did Trey Parker did heaps of research, and it's actually quite... like truthfully yep. told, and the settings that they actually shot it in the courthouse,
because it was called the Packer Party, like the story of the Packer Party,
right? Yeah,
yeah. Keep going.
I thought that was just a tongue twister.
Packer Party is good.
Is it Packer Par or Packer Poor? I don't know. Keep going.
Oh God! It all comes back to Packer Par.
The Packer Party.
If Pecker Party picked
pack
a
of
poor,
pickled passengers,
mm. he'd probably pass out.
Okay, so while Alfred Parker is awaiting execution, he's approached by journalist Polly Pry to tell the story of his ill-fated trip from Utah to Colorado Territory with a group of miners. So you get flashbacks to 1873, the expedition, as the group breaks into amazingly hilarious songs. And, you know, eventually resort to ripping each other's skin off. So the music is incredible, and you can see how they went on to make the South Park movie, Team America and the Book of Mormon. And there have been numerous stage productions of it over the years, which, oh my God, I would kill to yeah. go to one of those. It would be amazing. You also can't help but love the characters. They're so wholesome. And after we screened... because we just
Spadoinkle.
Yeah. After we screened Tucker and Dale last Saturday night... it just reminded me of that. Yeah. Just like these wholesome characters that you can't help but love.
These wholesome backwards characters.
Yeah. And it's so earnest and just, oh, it's so sweet. And Glenn, you were telling me about the DVD commentary, which unfortunately I didn't have a chance to watch yet.
So it's one of the greatest commentaries you'll ever hear because they play a drinking game as they go. And by the end of it, they are so paralytically drunk that they can't even get words out. So you can't even understand what they're talking about.
Maybe us tonight.
Yeah, it could be because I could tell you my second glass is mostly whiskey. So that'll be very interesting. I'm heating up quite substantially.
Me too.
I'm thinking the fucking heater's on. It's like, no.
It's all internal. It's radiating off your body.
Anyway, no, but it is one of the funniest audio commentaries you'll ever hear. Yeah, well worth it.
Yeah.
What I loved about Cannibal the Musical is the way they color grade it. Everything's fluoro. Yeah. Like the greens are fluoro and the reds are fluoro. It's hilarious.
Oh, it's so hilarious. It's so good. I absolutely love it. So good.
And that's the epitome of a cult film, I reckon.
Mm.
Yeah. Oh, midnight screenings. We should like do a regular Good Movie Monday.
Absolutely.
Midnight
screening. Like
at my house with us, no one else. Like, not invited. Everyone.
No, I was going to say, we should do it. We should do it at the upstairs dining area of KFC in Oakley. Like, no one ever goes to that upstairs area. We just bring in a projector.
We
turn
ate
off the
there
lights.
And didn't go upstairs.
Yeah.
I mean, goodness.
And then just, you ring the bell for more KFC.
Yeah.
There's another partnership, a collab in the making, right?
Yeah,
Colonel, hit us up.
All right, so that's your recommendation.
That's my first recommendation.
Fantastic. Yep. I love that one.
How's it going, everybody? It's Guillermo here again from ScreenRealm.com. The website is back. That is the good news. It's back, but it's only just back. So we're still in the process of populating the site once again with the latest. Although we do have your latest Australian streaming release schedules there, so you can check out what's coming up on Netflix, Amazon Prime, Shudder, etc. Let me catch you up on just some of the big movie news that occurred during the last week. Kicking off with Cameron Diaz officially coming out of retirement for a Netflix action film titled Back in Action. Also set to star Jamie Foxx. Now this is to be an action comedy set to be directed by Seth Gordon, whose credits include Horrible Bosses, Identity Thief, and 2017's Baywatch. Gordon also wrote the screenplay with Brendan O'Brien, whose credits include Bad Neighbors, Bad Neighbors 2, and Mike and Dave Need Wedding Dates. No plot details for Back in Action are known as yet. This is set to be Cameron Diaz's first film in around 8 years. Her last feature credit was the musical Annie, and that was back in 2014, and Jamie Foxx also starred in that one. And it appears that James Bond fans have a few years at least before we know a little more as to what we can expect in the next iteration. James Bond producer Barbara Broccoli has told Deadline that it will be, quote, at least 2 years, end quote, before the next 007 movie even begins filming. As for the search for who will be replacing Daniel Craig in the role, the journey hasn't even started, apparently. Nobody's in the running, Broccoli said. We're working out where to go with him, we're talking that through. There isn't a script, and we can't come up with one until we decide how we're going to approach the next film, because really, it's a reinvention of Bond. We're reinventing who he is, and that takes time. I'd say that filming is at least 2 years away. Oscar winner Russell Crowe has signed up to star in a supernatural thriller titled The Pope's Exorcist. The film is going to be directed by Australian filmmaker Julius Avery, known for Overlord and Son of a Gun. Crowe is going to be playing real-life Father Gabriel Amorth, a legendary Italian priest who performed over 100,000 exorcisms for the Vatican. The plot will be taking elements from his best-selling memoirs, An Exorcist Tells His Story and An Exorcist More Stories. Father Amorth died in 2016, and Screen Gems acquired his life rights along with the rights to his memoirs. Joe and Anthony Russo, directors of Marvel films such as Avengers Endgame and Infinity War, as well as upcoming Netflix action film The Gray Man, will be staying at Netflix for their next feature, The Electric State, which is set to star Stranger Things actress Millie Bobby Brown. Chris Pratt is reportedly also circling a co-star role. The Electric State is going to be based on an illustrated novel by Simon Stallenhag and is going to be set in a retro-futuristic past, where an orphan teen, played by Millie Bobby Brown, traverses the American West with a sweet but mysterious robot and an eccentric drifter in search of her younger brother. That about does it for me, guys. Be sure to join Screen Realm on YouTube and all over social media. Thanks so much for having me. Catch you next week.
this night's bed. I don't know where I'm going, only God knows where I've been. I'm a devil on the run, a six-gun lover, a candle in the wind.
Was it actually ever possible, Ben, for us to have a Western theme show without Blaze of Glory?
No, I don't think it's really possible. I think you edit it out every week, but I think there's always there's always some kind of Bon Jovi kind of talk, yeah, in the background, like. For a married straight man, you have an unhealthy obsession with John Bon Jovi.
John Bon Jovi is pretty wonderful.
It's the denim.
The fact that you keep sharing those those hidden karaoke videos of Bon Jovi, you know, interrupting people when they're singing. Funny enough, Blaze of Glory.
What a fucking awesome song though, like a banger, like Young Guns 2. Like that is also one of the great Part 2 sequels in my mind. Do you like Young Guns 2? I almost like it more than number one.
Well, I like it because it's got Ginger Lynn Allen in it.
Of course you do. You can kiss my ass.
But like I look, to be honest, I always found the fact that Young Guns 2 existed to be really weird because they seemingly killed all the famous people in Young Guns.
Well, that's interesting, isn't it? Because number two is the fable. So number two is like, because there's a true story of this guy called Brushy Bob or whatever his name is in the 50s that came out claiming to be Billy the Kid. It's well documented. So they've taken that theory and run with it. So he tells the story in the 1950s of when he was Billy the Kid way back. So they've kind of found that little entry point to retell the story.
Yeah.
As if it, you know, the first one kind of didn't end that way.
And who's Pat Garrett in?
William Peterson.
Is it William Peterson?
Yeah.
In my head it was Dermot Mulroney. But,
he's in the first one.
Yeah.
He'd choose all the tobacco.
Yeah.
The tobacco. You know, the producers of Young Guns 2 wanted to use Dead or Alive, the Bon Jovi song. That's the one they really wanted to go for because that's a Western song. Yeah. But Bon Jovi's like, absolutely not. You don't understand the song. Like, it's not about that at all. It's got another meaning. And he goes, well, I'll tell you what, I'll go and write a song especially for you, which is Blaze of Glory. And then he actually ended up writing an entire album, which is inspired by Young Guns 2. So the soundtrack is not really music from the movie. It's just, imagine if it was.
And that, dear listener, every week. Every week I have to listen to this Bon Jovi. The history of Bon Jovi. It's better than if he was obsessed with you too, I will admit.
We did Bloody Sunday the other week. Well, I mean, I guess you'd call Young Guns what a rock and roll western if you're going to coin anything. And there's a few of those over the years. You had Posse. Do you remember that one?
I do remember Posse.
That was the black version of Young Guns.
And then was it not Hooded Angels? There was a kind of a Bad artificial
Girls?
Sequel where they're all it was. Black women in a black women.
So something
western.
Like Hooded Angels.
I think it was actually.
That's the challenge for the listener. Dear listener, hit us up on Facebook.
Yeah, on the socials.
So I can't look it up.
Oh, well, you're going to have to fly on, like, off the seat of your pants, mate. You haven't got the internet to back
black
up.
Black Roses or something like that, I think it was called.
Wow. Did you just hear the pour of another whiskey? Yeah, like I said, Bad Girls, you know, with Drew Barrymore and
Madeline Stowe. Yep. And, is Matt McCoy in that one?
Oh, we don't talk
no,
about
he's in Hard Bounty. Jim Wynorski. Jim Wynorski did a Western called Hard Bounty that came out around the same time as Bad Girls with Kelly LeBrock and Matt McCoy from Leviathan. The movie, not the Hellraiser
documentary.
Oh,
this is a really great episode for loyal listeners.
Yeah.
This one.
A lot of callbacks.
Yeah. And the Newton Boys, I guess. We talked about that on our gangster episode, but that's a Western, and that was very much a Young Guns type of, you know, hotshot Hollywood cast kind of movie.
Is that
Richard Linklater, I think, directed that one.
I don't think I've ever actually seen it. That's the one with Teresa Russell. Is she the mum?
I don't remember. I knew it was
that
the male
the
cast.
Mar
in that
Baker
one.
Or the Baker Boys or something like that.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
You know, there's one that's all about Mar Baker, which is the part of the Boney M song, Baker. They made a movie about that.
Yeah. No, I don't know what
about
it
those characters, but she's the mother.
Okay.
I can't remember who the kids are. But because I thought Newton Boys was like a Bonnie and Clyde era.
It kind of is. Like, it kind of teeters on
like
the line.
Like
of
a more of a 30s.
It comes up in a lot of Western lists.
Like, what's the other one with Angie Dickinson? That's also Jim Wynorski did the sequel to it. what was that called?
I can't wait for this Wynorski episode.
The internet. I wish the internet worked. What is it called? Big Bad Mama.
No, I know that one.
Yeah, Big Bad Mama and Big Bad Mama 2.
Yeah, right. Okay.
She's basically Ma Baker.
Yeah.
But in the first one, I'm pretty sure in the first one, the love interest... is Tom Skerritt, Robert Culp and William Shatner are the love interests.
Interesting.
That's in the sequel, but yeah.
Well, another one I did watch, which Young Guns kind of made me think of, which is made much later, I think it was 2000, was Michael Wittenbottom made The Claim with Sarah Polley and
Wes Bentley.
Bentley. And I was watching it thinking, I remember this being great. It's not. It's not at all. Like,
I remember putting it on in the video store and going, yeah, where's that fucking bag?
Yeah.
Because like, it was like after yeah. American Beauty.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're like, come on, is this, that's all this guy can do.
But the interesting, what I found interesting is because most recently you and I have been right through the whole Yellowstone series, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Wes is in that. And he's uncharacteristically different. Like he's not the character we know him from in all these other movies. And the juxtaposition between him and The Claim, which is a Western, and Yellowstone, which is a modern Western, like no comparison. Interesting. Anyway, speaking of Yellowstone, how's that for a segue? Like, yes, my interview with Richard Gray. He's a Melbourne lad. He rose up through the Aussie Project Greenlight. Isn't that interesting? We talked about that a few weeks ago as if, you know, it was something that, you know, no one's heard of before. And lo and behold, this guy's been through.
I believe to win, though, he had to do the little lad dance.
He came second. And so after that, his first film was one I loved for many years called Summer Coda, which had Rachel Taylor. It was all set up in the area up in Mildura where they grow all the oranges, and it was about backpackers and things like that. It was a good one. And then he went on to make the footy movie Blinder before he moved over to the States and made The Lookalike and Sugar Mountain, and of course the Braveheart quasi sequel Robert the Bruce, which I don't think he appreciates being described as a Braveheart sequel. as you'll hear in this conversation.
Literally. It's Angus McFadden, who is Robert the Bruce in Braveheart.
Yeah, I know.
Like, if you didn't want it to be a Braveheart sequel, maybe cast someone else.
Yeah, that's right. But his latest movie is the Western Murder at Yellowstone City, which has an all-star cast including Gabrielle Byrne, Richard Dreyfuss, Nat Wolff, Anna Camp, Anna Garcia, and more. And, of course, this guy, Thomas Jane, who we're going to hear from first. Then you're going to hear from Richard. And just to be known, Richard's interview is cut down in size. If you want to hear the full thing, Tuesday night on our YouTube and Facebook pages, you'll see the full interview in visual form. So anyway, here you go. These two.
So much for your divine grace.
Hey, Thomas, how's it going, mate?
Let's see. I'm doing good. I'm just recovering from the jet lag of flying back from Europe. I was in the UK for 3 weeks, or I was actually in France for 3 weeks.
Oh, you never stop.
Yeah, I'm a little beat, but we had a lot of fun there. It took my dad trout fishing on the Dordogne River, and caught a couple of trout. My mom cooked them up. It was memorable.
That's amazing, because you got to be one of the hardest working actors I know of, and I was going to ask how you managed to find time between projects for that sort of R&R.
Yeah, it's good. It's just life-saving. You got to do it, you know.
Absolutely.
You got to carve out some time and just go off the grid for a while and figure out how to reset, you know?
I do. Yes, absolutely. Look, it's great to be chatting with you, mate. You are basically an honorary Aussie.
Yeah, no shit. By now, I think I am. I had a lot of fun down there and up there in Queensland. It's a pretty exotic place, I think, even for most Australians, you know. It's at least the guys up there were saying, yeah, this isn't really what the rest of Australia looks like, you know. It's very tropical up there. It's lush. There's of course all the wildlife is pretty extreme, and the people.
You were far north, were you, like up near Cairns?
Yeah, I went up there to scuba dive the Great Barrier Reef.
Amazing.
And the show Troppo takes place up in a place like Cairns, you know.
Yeah.
But we shot a little bit south of that near Brisbane.
Awesome. Well, we're here to talk about Murder at Yellowstone City. Dude, this is such a classic type of Western, and you're no stranger to Westerns. You've been in plenty of them. Have you always been a fan of the genre? Or what's the appeal for you?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's the thing where me and my old man would sit around on Saturday afternoon and watch the old Sergio Leone Westerns. And then I got into the John Ford stuff, when I got a little older. All the old great Westerns, you know, Anthony Mann made a few. In other words, yeah, I'm a fan, and I've always wanted to to do it, but you know, they weren't making Westerns for a long time. There was a sort of a fallow period in Hollywood where, I mean, I was trying to get a Western made for 10 years or not 10 years ago.
Yeah,
I was trying to get a Western made. Nobody would touch it. You know? Now we're having a little string of them. So I'm proud of that.
Yeah. And so you should be. This one's a great one. And it was filmed at the Yellowstone Film Ranch, which looks amazing. And this is, for people that don't know, this is a facility that Richard Gray basically built from scratch with a couple of partners. And I've been following his social media and behind-the-scenes production shots, and he seemed to look like a kid in Candyland, man. Like, you know, can you talk about working with him and your thoughts on the ranch?
Well, we were the first. Yeah, Richie and his buddies built the ranch to make Westerns, and we were the first guys to sort of shoot there and memorialize the ranch on film. And then since then, it's been pretty nonstop over there where Westerns have been moving in. Other Westerns to shoot there. And so what's great is you get a lot of these towns, if you're a Western fan, you've seen them before. You know, they change the signs and they repaint a couple buildings, but it's the same old town. This is a new one, you know, and it's really well done. I mean, the guys who built it did a bang up job. It's built to last, you know. There's no facade that's being propped up by a couple of 2x4s. This is like all the buildings are real. You can shoot in them and outside and around them. We had, it was an extraordinary amount of fun to shoot. We had some great crew, you know, our horse wranglers became buddies and we've worked together again on a different Western. It's good. Good times, you know. I hope this run lasts. And thanks for saying that Yellowstone is good, because every good Western that comes out means that they'll make a couple of more, you know.
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm a big fan of Westerns, and like, I think it might have something to do also with the fact that he built this whole backlot, you know, from scratch. But there's an authenticity to it, that's for sure.
We had a great story, and we had got some great actors involved. And
speaking of the actors, like, what an incredible cast! You know, Gabrielle Byrne and Richard Dreyfuss, Isaiah Mustafa, Nat Wolff, Amy Garcia, Anna Camp, amongst others. Like, this must be a hard film to say no to.
Yeah, you get a good script, and you're darn right. I mean, that's why you see a lot of established, really good actors in the show, because you get a good script, everybody wants to show up for that, you know. You know, and that's reflected in, you know, getting guys like Dreyfuss out there, who was a legend, you know, such a kind man, but all full of all the great stories, from Close Encounters to Jaws and all the other things that he's done over the years. Having a guy like that around, sort of the godfather of actors, one of the godfathers of actors, it was really fun.
Is he like the class clown that I would like to think he is?
He's got a great sense of humor, I tell you that.
Awesome. and given that you guys were all shooting on location in Paradise Valley, which is practically Yellowstone, I imagine it was hard to get away from each other. So were you a really, you know, close-knit group of friends?
Well, you know, I mean, I think you're right. When you spend 5 days a week together and it's 12, 14-hour days, you know, on the weekends, personally, I just kind of want to get the hell on a river somewhere and go fly fishing, which is what I did. My dad flew out and we went up to the Yellowstone. We got ourselves a guide and we did a wonderful fishing trip, you know, a couple of times up there. It's really fun. So that's what I do.
What a place to make a living.
Yeah, right. I hear a lot of people are moving out there now after the pandemic. People are looking to get out of big cities, and Montana's always been, you know, absolutely gorgeous.
Did the pandemic have any effect on this production?
Well, the answer is no, because you're out in the middle of nowhere. You're pretty well isolated. You know, you're not in contact with a whole lot of people, and of course we've got the COVID protocols and stuff, but it was pretty darn relaxed because we were all pretty self-contained and safe. You know, we didn't have any problems.
Awesome. Awesome. Can you tell me about playing a preacher amongst cowboys? Did you draw any influence or inspiration from anything, or did you sort of dive into it with your own sort of take on it?
Well, I mean, God, let me see if I can dig up the movie here. Well, you know, who's the famous famous preacher? The movie directed by Charles Laughton. You know, the name escapes me. There's so many damn movies. But anyway, he played a classic kind of preacher. Now he was bad, a bad dude. He had a good and evil tattooed on each of his hands. You know, he was a charismatic character though, and I think some of my costume comes from that film.
Oh, we talking about was that Night of the Hunter? Is that the one?
That's the one.
That is the one. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Night of the Hunter. Fuck yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing film.
So, yeah, it's his only movie, Charles Laughton directed. Okay. And unfortunately, because, well, it didn't do well at the box office and he got depressed about that and never did another one. But it's really too bad because it's damn close to being a masterpiece.
Completely agree.
Not a Western. It's a film noir, but it definitely has, you know, it has a good feel. It's it takes place in the country. There's a river and, you know, there's traveling through farmland. So it's got that feel to it.
Yeah. I mean, he's got a horse and wagon that comes up over the horizon. It's very Western in its tropes.
So, yeah. So it was an inspiration for me for sure.
Yeah. Cool. There's been quite a few Aussie directors who've made American Westerns. Do you think the Aussies bring some kind of different sensibility to the genre, or do you just think it's what's on the page is what's on the screen?
I think Australia and the West, the classic sort of American West, have a lot of similarities. There's a lot of cowpunchers in both places. There's a lot of horses. There's a lot of land.
Mm.
You have to be tough to live off that land. You have to be resourceful. And there's often, you know, if you need a sheriff, he's a town away, he's a day away, you know, so you have to know how to take care of business yourself.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of similarities that I can come up with between Australia and the Old West. And I think there's been a lot of wonderful sort of Australian Westerns that have done pretty well.
Yep.
And there's also, you know, some actors that have come over and crew and like Richie, you know, guys who contribute to the Western. I could see the affinity and why we have artists from Australia who have made some good contributions to the Western.
Absolutely. And while we're on the subject of the Aussies, you are no stranger to Australia, as we established earlier on. You've filmed quite a few things down mm-hmm. here and you've worked with lots of Aussies over there. What keeps bringing you back mm-hmm. here?
I think the people and the there's a little bit of an out, not an outlaw, but there's a little bit of a, you know, a roguish sense to a lot of Australians that I really connect with. And, you know, and they have a wonderful sense of humor, and but they're, you know, they're a hearty bunch. And I relate to that. I feel good around Australians, you know. So I guess whenever I get the opportunity, it's hard for me to say no,
yeah,
to go back there. And, you know, my first production company, first television show is this Troppo. That's our first one for the production company, my production company called Renegade. And we got to shoot it in Australia. You know, we were down there for 5 months. So there's no, you know, I think there's no coincidences in this life. And looks like I'll be coming back up there to shoot season two. So
amazing.
I'll be spending a lot of time there.
That's got Jocelyn Morehouse on it, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. She directed the pilot. She did a great job.
Oh, I love her. Her film, The Dressmaker, is basically a Western.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, she's a slick filmmaker. I really had a great time. We had a lot of great cast and crew. They were all Australian except for me. I'm the only American in the whole thing. Everybody else, the whole crew. And we just had a blast, you know. We had a really, really strong artists and technicians on that show. And I'm sure they'll all want to come back to do season two. So
that's really good to hear. Fun. I mean, down here, I don't know what it is. Maybe it's the distance, but we do love it when people like yourself come and work here. It's, you know, it's just we're chuffed when you do.
Well, I think that with the success of Troppo and these other things, we'll probably see more of that. You know, you'll probably get more crossover. And you know, with Renegade, we did a true co-production. So it was we had an American Australian true co-production, and so that was, I think we'll see more of that too.
Very, very cool. Very cool. Now, Before I let you run and get on with things, I just want to pay you this compliment because you've been in some of my favorite films of the last few years, some that which I would say are probably lesser known to some people, The Vanished, Hunter's Moon, Axel, and Run, Hide, Fight particularly. Like, thank you so much, sir. It's been great watching you over the last few years. And, of course, I've been a fan since Thursday. That's how far back I go, you know, loving your stuff.
Right on. Yeah. That was a fun script.
Yeah, there's a fanboy in me right now that's especially thrilled to be chatting with you, so I do appreciate your time.
That's great. That's terrific. Well, wait, what part of the Australia are you in?
I'm down in Melbourne.
Okay. Yeah, well, you make it up to Queensland, you have to bring me a pack of those Tim Tams, double chocolate.
All right. We can do a Tim Tam slam.
Yeah, damn right. Man, I fell in love with those.
Yeah, everyone does.
Those are hard to find around here. Yeah, I mean, but the double chocolate, not the triple chocolate. That's a little too rich, but the double chocolate's perfect.
Oh, consider it done, mate. It's in the bag already.
Oh, thanks, buddy. Good talking to you.
G'day, Richard. How's it going, mate?
Good. How are you, buddy? I like all the questions you got back.
Yeah, man. Look, you know, it's my sanctuary where I'm at right now. You know, I reckon you and I, we go way back because I reckon you were projecting movies to me back in the day at the old Hoyt Cinemas.
That's true. That's a funny story. But yeah, I started work at Forest Hill Chase 10 when I was 15 years old. That's where I grew up in Box Hill.
Far out, man. Like, yeah, my side of town. But dude, you know, I remember going to see Mothman Prophecies and Angel Eyes and things like that. You know, I reckon you were the guy behind the lamp.
one of my favorite jobs when they still had projectionists.
Yeah, I bet, man. I bet. So if you could go back in time, how would your younger self react if you told them that one day you'd be directing not only like a quasi-sequel to Braveheart, but then following that up with a Western starring Gabrielle Byrne and Richard Dreyfuss, amongst others? Surely he would be spun out.
Yeah, I don't know. The steps are so small that you never really think about it like that. It's always the next step. And also being an indie filmmaker, where's the next job coming from? And then, you know, my family and I made the decision to move to LA, basically just so we could continue to make films and that would be our thing. I'd done a lot of the TV world in Australia and I just wanted to make movies. And so it seemed like that was the best pathway if you wanted to make movies regularly enough to pay the rent.
Like Murder at Yellowstone City, dude, what a classic brand of Western this is. How did this all come about?
Right, so great script. So the guy that wrote Robert the Bruce, which is just a tiny little spin-off of Braveheart. It's got nothing to do with Braveheart. It's more like a kid's fable, but it was something that I was really passionate about the story on. He wrote this Western, Eric Balgow, and he wanted to make a classic Western, but that hit on some really crucial subjects, but also was wrapped in a thriller. And I love that idea of it. And I love the idea that it was a classic Western. And I read it and just fell in love with it. And so there's so many great Westerns to draw upon. But when I was growing up, like we had the fun style Westerns that I would see with my dad, the Silverados and the Three Amigos and things that were The Quick and the Dead and these type of things, right? But my favorite Western's always been Once Upon a Time in the West, just Westerns on epic proportion. And then we got lucky with, you know, films like The Proposition in Australia, Unforgiven here, Jesse James, more atmospheric type Westerns came in, and then very dark Westerns have come in. So it was cool to read a script that was more classic. And that's what we embraced with a fabulous cast. And you're right, you do pinch yourself when you're on set with, you know, Gabriel Byrne, Thomas Jane, Richard Dreyfuss, Anna Camp, Amy Garcia, these guys are brilliant. And I've wanted to work with them for a long time. So it was lovely that they felt the same way about the script.
For sure. And you said that you embraced the genre. Like, where was your mind at? Were you trying to hit certain tropes, or were you trying to avoid various things?
Yeah, we knew we wanted to keep the photography classical, but we wanted to make it voyeuristic because we don't know who did it, and everybody's looking at each other and everyone's judging each other. But we didn't want to be too showy with the camera. And then Westerns these days have become such a mashup in recent years that we just wanted to stay true to the characters and trying to paint scenes in a setting that felt realistic to them. Mm-hmm. So whether it was Isaiah or Cicero in his world, or it was Gabriel trying to keep the peace even at the cost of justice, or Thomas Jane and Anna Camp, that Anna, the women really drive the film. Tanea Beattie, who plays Violet Running Horse, if it's not for her feeling something was wrong with the arrest that leads to Anna to know that she can't stand by it. They really push the dudes to step up.
Yeah,
and Amy Garcia, who runs the town from the brothel, it was kind of powerful that the women kind of decided that this was not right, that Isaiah Cicero would be arrested, and they make the push that it's not okay. And back then, if they're pretending to believe in God or they're believing in God, it wasn't okay to know that somebody was innocent and just stand by.
Yeah, no, that definitely, like you said, that's the crux of it. And it is such an authentic kind of genre film as well. Like, there's just something to it. Like, maybe that's to do with the script, or maybe it's to do with the fact that you did build this entire city from scratch, very real. It's not like, you know, it's not fake, you know? It's
funny because we sat there, you know, for 3 years building it. And so you were imagining it the whole time. And the Yellowstone Film Ranch is just in such a beautiful spot on the river, just 30 minutes from Yellowstone. And it was easy to imagine it. Usually when you're making a film, you don't get a lot of time on the set, and you're trying to fit a script into what you're given on the set. We had the opposite experience because we could build what the story calls for.
Yeah. And I've been watching your social media presence for the last couple of years with the ranch, and you just look like a kid in a milk bar with $20 to spend, mate. Like, you just you look like you're in your element. Is that your paradise?
It is my paradise. I don't know why. My grandfather, who I never met, grew up not far from here and was US Army. And then met my mom and my grandmother in Melbourne. There's something about this area that I'm very close to, like Scotland. And Ireland, where my family's from, I just feel very at home here. And getting out during the pandemic after being in LA for 11 years, it just the timing, we were very, very lucky. We got out just before the pandemic. And to be in Montana, where there's just so much space and very little lockdown, it was the perfect time to build a Western town in the middle of nowhere.
For sure. I'm a huge fan, as everyone is, of Richard Dreyfuss. Having him on board, that must be a dream. I imagine him to be a joker. Is he?
He is. And he's an historian, so you've got to be on your toes. So when you go into these first phone calls or these Zooms, you're nervous because you're talking to Richard Dreyfuss. And then he asks you about your American history or where this was in Montana in 1881. You better be ready. But he's a brilliant man. But he's a funny, funny guy. But just so supportive. And every step of the way, he's checking in: how we going? How we doing? When's the premiere? What we doing? Like, he wants to do more. He's got another Western that he wants to do with us. He was one of those dream experiences that are rare when you get somebody with a body of work that you're just a fan of, but it's giving you the opportunity to do the best you can and direct it. And that was awesome.
And a little bit of a throwback right before I do wrap this up with you, but and I've loved chatting with you, by the way, but I used to own a video store, and believe it or not, your first film, Summer Coda, was my manager's pick for a good 12 months on the shelf. So, yeah, I absolutely adored that film when it came out.
I love that film. It's funny, we're having the LA premiere of Murder at Yellowstone City in the same theater we premiered Summer Coda. It's loosely based on how my parents met, and Mildura is where I got married. And that was the best time. After Project Greenlight, came second in that. It took 8 years to get that film up after coming second in Project Greenlight. And I think that was the impetus to like get going making movies, because I didn't want to wait.
Damn straight.
Another it's 8 years.
It's a beautiful, beautiful film. Such a good film. I love it.
Appreciate it.
You so much for taking some time to chat. I'm loving your work, man, and I'm loving watching you on social media, because the joy just comes out in those photos of the ranch.
Anytime, brother. You've got to come over here.
I'm probably in Canada next year, so maybe.
Giddy up.
We are now talking about the American genre. And what genre is that? You're right, gangster pictures. So we're not going to talk about that. We're going to move right on to Westerns.
And I will argue, too, that Australia itself makes a lot of damn good Westerns itself. So, I mean,
name one. They've got that Quigley. What other they got other than Quigley? Lightning Jack?
Seen that one? It's good.
We will go with Lightning Jack.
I can't even pronounce Seraphim Falls. The only place they ever made them that were good was America. Screw Spain, screw Italy, screw Australia.
Yeah, let's not. Yeah, we'll just not talk about the proposition or anything.
What are you proposing?
I'll tell you one I want to talk about that I watched. This, I caught it once, didn't know what it was, but it had John Wayne in it. So I was like, well, God, I got to watch it. Because I knew when I started, I'm like, Dad will know what it is. And I was watching, and the scene I came in on was John Wayne. Literally, these guys are all fighting in the background. And then John Wayne stands up, the guy you don't know who it is yet. And he goes, everybody else is. And he punches the guy. And the guy gets up and punches him back. And that would have been Rock Hudson was the guy that punches him back. And it's not a great film. It's not even the best John Wayne film. We won't get into the complications of who John Wayne was. But I love the cast, because it has Royal Dano, Harry Carey Jr., Bruce Cabot, the best of the Michael Vincents. That's Jan Michael Vincent, and of course Lee Merriweather, and that's the undefeated. And the plot is almost ludicrous. Ex-Confederate soldiers are heading.
You're not going to do the plot, are you?
Ex-Confederate soldiers are heading to Mexico. They run into ex-Union cavalry men who are selling horses to the Mexican government, but then they have to fight Mexican bandits and they team up. It's not a great movie.
Nationalist at best.
John Wayne was involved.
John Wayne?
In a nationalist movie?
Mine is going that I have never got to talk about on here, or maybe I have. 1969 was a great year, other than it being my favorite number, for the best Western comedy of all time. Okay, no, it's the second best Western comedy of all time. Support your local.
Evil Roy Slade?
It's the third best Western comedy of all time. With James Garner and Walter Brennan, support your local sheriff. A grifter, bad person, blah, 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 he plays, James Garner does, waltzes into town and becomes a sheriff just for the pay, figuring he can just screw over every side. Kind of like Yojimbo.
You're going to have to wait till we get the bars installed, but don't cross that line.
It's got Bruce Dern. It's got Jack Elam. It's got Harry Morgan. I've got the half sheet in my bathroom, hanging in the basement, and it's one of my favorite movies from my childhood. They made a sequel really quick called Support Your Local Gunfighter, which isn't bad, just not quite as good. It doesn't have all the good lines like James just did. They haven't actually put the bars in, and he just puts paint there and goes, well, what's that? And he goes, that's what happened to the last guy I tried to get out. And he's scared, and he doesn't know that he's full of shit.
Legit one or not legit one?
Both. Legit.
All right, legit.
Too legit.
Okay.
Too legit
so,
to quit.
Again, this is one of those genres that is one of my personal favorites. Now, it wasn't as a kid. I actually did not get into Westerns until I was in my late teens. I could not get into them. And now I can't stop watching them. And I have talked about several of my favorites. Yeah, I'm going to talk. It was rebelling against my father. We'll say that. I could list a bunch of my favorites, but I want to talk about one that I just saw recently that really stuck with me. I had not seen it when it was her first release in 2003. Open Range. I just watched it for the first time 2 weeks ago. It's directed by Kevin Costner. It's based on a novel by Lauren Payne called The Open Range Men, and it's written by Craig Storper. It stars Kevin Costner, Robert Duvall, a young Diego Luna, and Annette Bening, and I could go on and on, and Michael Gambon. But it's all about this group of people who are just taking cattle across the West, and they're open ranging. They have the rights to feed on their cattle, but this land baron comes in and says you cannot feed on. It's just about them trying to feed, and then this baron comes in with his henchmen and makes it miserable for them, and they come back with a vengeance. And it is all about them planning their attack. And it you don't think things are going to work. Go one way. It's inconceivable that it happens the way that it does, but it's an entertaining watch. Watching it happen, and it may have been Kevin Costner's last great film, in my opinion. It is a perfectly paced Western.
Yep.
It is a wonderful movie. And by the way, my gag one, Billy the Kid versus Dracula. This has been Bonehead Weekly Fun Size.
Ben, I think those boneheads need an education in Australian cinema, wouldn't you say?
Yes, I concur.
Of course, they're being facetious and all, but they inadvertently opened up a door for us to talk about those meat pie westerns, which I think we should do.
Sure.
My first recommendation is actually the great meat pie western in my eyes. But before I talk about that, let's talk about some others. Chad mentioned The Proposition, which I think is fair enough. That's probably one of the greats. You a fan of that one?
No, it's fantastic. Not as good as Quigley Down Under.
Quigley Down Under, come on. That has appreciated a lot more over the years than it probably should have. I remember it being an average movie. The reception was always a bit, like we joked about it, but I watched it last year and it's fucking heavy ass.
Well, the thing is, it kind of, you think going into it, that's going to be like a lighthearted Tom Selleck kind of romp, like, you know, Magnum in the Wild West. And then they start committing acts of genocide.
Yeah, horrifically.
Holy shit. What am I watching? And I personally, I like to think that Baz Luhrmann's Australia is just a shitty remake of Quigley Down Under. Yeah.
Well, I'm so glad you mentioned Baz Luhrmann's Australia because that ties in really nicely with my first recommendation. So just to quickly throw some other meat pie Western titles out there. Recently we had The Nightingale, we had Sweet Country, The Legend of Ben Hall. I can't do an episode without mentioning that. The Tracker. You know, that's what a meat pie Western is. It's essentially, you know, because we're not West in Australia.
No. So, we're very much South.
That's right. So meat pie is our spaghetti.
Yeah.
We don't have any other cuisine that we can lean on.
Yeah.
Like a damper Western? It doesn't have the same ring to it. Because did they even have meat pie? I suppose if they had pies, they had meat pies. Yeah, that's right. But in the American sense, do they have meat pies? Because... like they have mince pies.
Well, they don't have
pies
them,
yeah, like a dessert. Right?
A meat yeah. pie for Gross. Them, the way we have it, it's a family sized thing. It's a big deep dish meat pie. For us, it's a single serve. It's a fast food. It's at the football. You know, that's
it's something that you get at the servo.
Yeah, yeah. for American listeners, that's a gas station. We're as ochre as can be, mate. Talking about meat pie westerns.
They're lucky that we're not calling it a meat pie-o.
Never mind the pie floater. I don't do that. That's shit ass. Anyway, so my favorite of all the Australian meat pie westerns, it's from the 1950s. I forgot to write down. No, 40s. I think it's 1946, and it is fuck, what's it called? I've forgotten where I'm at. It's the whiskey.
Now,
you were too busy worrying about the date and then forgot about the...
No, it's the Overlanders.
Now who's making fun of who without the mobile phone? Remind them of these salient details.
So the Overlanders, which is 1946, it stars Chips Rafferty, who was like the golden boy of Australian cinema back then. But back then we made, this is where I'm trying to tie it in with Australia. We made these really, really epic sprawling westerns back then that were as good, if not better, than a lot of what was coming out of America. Like, we had big productions. Quite often, they were American productions that came to Australia.
Mm. Well, the big one, like, I remember was The Sundowners with Robert Mitchum. And Deborah Kerr. Yeah. Like, doing Australian accents.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Although, no, was he an Aussie accent? I remember one of those.
Deborah Kerr definitely was.
Because I remember one of them, he was an American in Australia, in trying Australia. To make a go of it.
But that was a big thing back here, because, you know, we used to have all the radio plays.
Yeah.
And people like Rod Taylor got their start. Even and Chips Rafferty, they did radio plays together.
Yeah.
But they, because all the radio plays for the most part were American ones,
yeah,
they all did shockingly bad
yeah, yeah.
American accents yeah, in that's them. Right. But
so the reason I'm bringing Australia into it is because these are the movies that Baz Luhrmann was, you know, throwing homage to. He was, you know, being nostalgic for them. And I think as much as Australia is a movie you can make fun of easily, a lot of people misunderstood what his intention was, and that was to sort of recreate that weird Hollywood, you know, sort of Western from Australia. Like, it was a weird kind of hybrid of a movie. Anyway, Overlanders is spectacular. I've watched this many times. I think it's stunning. It's epic and, you know, as I said, sprawling and adventurous. And it's about a guy who, I think it's the 1920s it's set, and Australia is on the cusp of war, and there's the fear of the Japanese invading Darwin. And so they're told to get rid of all the cattle, like just leave them and everyone head south. And this guy's like, I'm not leaving the cattle behind. And he puts his hand up to drove them across from WA, across Northern Territory, all the way to Queensland. And he takes his family and a couple of sort of farmhands with him. And that's the movie. Droving cattle. It's like City Slickers, isn't it? Without the comedy. And he's droving.
Through the Red Centre.
Through the Red Centre. Nuts. Kakadu included. And so this movie is all about the trials and tribulations. They face the heat. They face crocodiles. They face, you know, all the elements. And it's a movie about the Australian outback, you know, coming to get you, pretty much. But I just love everything about it, because there are some scenes in here that I would say are some of the best ever shot. Have you watched it recently at all, Ben?
No, I did mean to make use of that fine umbrella Blu-ray release.
Yes, which is glorious, by the way.
But I did not.
There is a great moment in there where they face a river that they have to cross, and it's problematic and how they're going to get
it. A river runs through it.
Yeah.
And all the rivers run.
But the way they shoot this, it's a real big moment in the film. It goes for about half an hour, this sequence, but it really reminded me of William Friedkin's Fortress, like, you know, Sorceress, I should say.
Yeah. Yeah. How good would Fortress have been had it been directed
by Sorcerer? I got it wrong the second time as well.
Yeah, you did. Yeah. Well, I couldn't even think straight to like think about what you'd said. I'm like, oh, that doesn't seem right.
You know, when I'm this deep into the whiskey, it makes sense in my head.
Yeah.
But that scene in the movie in the Outlanders, the Overlanders. I'm fucking getting it wrong. Did I say Outlanders to begin with?
Funnily enough, I was actually going to watch Outlander as a Western, as my Western recommendation.
So if anybody's like paying attention to my recommendations,
not Outlander, sorry, Outland.
See, we're all doing
it. It's just Outland, isn't it? It's
Ben's Outland is the fumes.
Outland is the TV series.
It's a hot box of whiskey.
It
in
really
here.
Is.
I haven't been even close to alcohol in so long that it's doing it.
But talking about Chips Rafferty, like I said, he was the golden boy of Australian cinema back then, and he's been described as the Aussie Gary Cooper. I find him such an unlikely hero because he's so lanky and not very blokey.
I find it odd because Gary Cooper, especially when he was young, was like very pretty.
Yeah.
Where I was thought of him more as the Aussie John Wayne.
Yeah. Well, the interesting thing...
But later John Wayne.
And I find this about all of the Aussie farm, agriculture, Western, all these movies that, like, you know, what's the one with Jack Thompson? Longer Sunday or whatever? Or I can't remember.
Sunday Too Far Away.
That's the one. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah. But what I find interesting about these blokey Aussies in these movies is they've all got high-pitched voices. They're not like talking like this. They're like, you know, what are you doing, mate? You know, it's like very...
I was going to say, don't forget that they're actors, right? They're not actually cowboys.
No. But so, my point is that the perception of the cowboy back then and the Aussie man and the ruggedness.
They're not trying to.
They're not blokey at all.
But that's, you know, that's the other thing. Like, don't forget that Tom Cruise is like 5'6". Like, it's like they're all short. Yeah. They're all.
I don't make that mistake. Yeah. But I'm saying the way we project them as opposed to the Americans, which makes them out to be rugged and heroic, and that they're not. You know, in the Australian Western or the Meat Pie Western. Anyway, I need another drink. Ben, take it away. You're next.
Speaking of
fucking hell.
Speaking of drinks, I'm going to talk. My second recommendation is going to be 1969's Sam Whiskey, which is a movie that I caught on late night TV probably 20 years ago, and I only saw a snippet of it.
Mm-hmm.
But Angie Dickinson was in it, and she looked amazing. And I've bought it on...
Recommendation done.
I've bought it on DVD. I've bought it on Blu-ray. I had it on tape. I had it taped off TV when it came back. But I never actually watched it. I was like, later. I'll watch it later.
Well, if you haven't watched it, that means you taped it off the TV with commercials.
Definitely. If I could find the tape, it would definitely have the ads. I certainly didn't... I wasn't one of those...
Stay up and
crackpots who like what's the point of taping it if you're going to watch it and take out the ads to watch it again later
without the
and
ads.
Then come back from an ad break and you forget to press record again.
I had a few of those that my grandparents promised they would do and they fucking left out like the final act.
They gave you the fast forward key on the VCR, so you didn't have to bother taping
it. Back then,
it
was very much about the precision. It was about getting this perfect, taped off the TV movie that you can watch as if it's from the video store.
Yeah. Yeah. In glorious 4:3.
And now, 30 years later, you wish you'd left the commercials in because they're the best part.
Yes, absolutely. Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, commercials about Swagman. We would have that.
And
Lobby's World. Come on.
Just as a... hope no one important is listening. Just a little throwback to that Ghoulies release. Those TV cuts, I kept the ads in.
Oh, yes.
And they're American TV cuts. And they've actually got one of them, the guy goes to there's a horror haunt. Oof. Like one of those, the things where you kind of walk in, there's people dressed up and they run at you and stuff like that.
Haunt. Oh, yeah.
It's the whole thing. Best and thing he ever. Keeps, yeah. they keep... So that ad is on at every ad break of them at that horror haunt, just doing different things.
Amazing.
In
this is amazing.
90s.
That just
90s
increased
America.
The value of the fucking.
I love how
release.
He's finally spruiking this bloody release an hour later. It's when I was under pressure to do it, you, Glenn. I want to talk about it.
You threw me under the bus a little bit. I wasn't prepared at all. You're sitting there all pretty with your written script, so you know exactly what's coming with everything. Yeah. There's no surprises for
Most
Glennie
people
boy.
That have children will happily talk about them and, and talk them up.
No. I'm. You know that I'm gay for pay, Glenn. but it wasn't one of my children.
So we're gonna talk about this movie?
But so Sam Whiskey... it stars Burt Reynolds. It is a comedy western. Yeah. And I know that I'm pretty sure that I've said it on the show, if not on the show, off the show. I've talked about my general dislike for Burt Reynolds.
You have.
Especially in comedies.
I've heard it, so yeah.
And the funny thing is, I feel that way until I watch
the tide's the turning, film. Mate. You're like, you're starting to become a fan.
Yeah, then I watch the film and I'm like, he is really good. And he, like, the best thing, about, I think it's more his... appearances on talk shows that make me not like him.
It's the personality.
But he takes the piss out of himself in all of these movies.
Yeah.
And it's and Dom DeLuise.
We've had that conversation.
His stuff with Dom DeLuise, I just don't like it. I'll go back and watch the Cannibal Run films and give them another go. But basically in this film, he's Sam Whiskey, who's kind of like a hired troubleshooter kind of guy. Mm-hmm. And he gets hired by Angie Dickinson to recover sunken gold that her dead husband stole from the North during the Civil War.
Mm-hmm.
And she wants him to recover it, return it to, I think, Fort Knox without them knowing, because they still don't know that it's been stolen. And so she wants to secretly... So he has to recover this gold that's in the middle of this river and then break into Fort Knox, return the gold without anyone knowing, and escape. And, of course, he says no. And there's this great bit where he comes up to her hotel room. She tells him what she wants. And as she's telling him, he's saying, no way. There's no way I'm doing it. She kind of closes the door. And the next scene, they're in bed together. And he's like, well, okay, man. And throughout the whole, it's like a joke that goes throughout the whole film. Every time he tries to say no, she sleeps with him, and he's like, maybe I'll do it. It is quite funny. And he's got, along for the ride, he's got Clint Walker, who is one of my all-time favorite big men actors. He's Posey from The Dirty Dozen, if you're trying to think of who Clint Walker is. And Ossie Davis. And Ossie Davis plays like this blacksmith. And both of them, at the introduction to the Ossie Davis character, Burt Reynolds arrives in town where he's going to meet Angie Dickinson, and he wants to have a bath before the meeting.
Yep.
And Ossie Davis has it's all on this booking system, and Ossie Davis has reserved his spot in this bath for like a week. And and obviously they're not changing the water between every person who uses the bath in the Old West. So he's got the first bath, and he's there getting ready. And so Burt Reynolds in his cocky glory kind of comes and goes, I'd pay you a dollar and the bath cost 10 cents.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
He's like, I'll give you a dollar. Let me have the first bath. And he's like, nope. He's like, and then he kind of jokes and just like, he goes, oh, you're the blacksmith. Oh, this is great. How about $2 and I have the first bath? He's like, nope. He's like, how about $10 and I have the first bath? Nope. He goes, how about I just beat you up and then take the first bath? He's like, well, if you want to give it a try, and Ossie Davis proceeds to literally beat Burt Reynolds around the saloon. And it is like a hilarious kind of slapstick fight scene with Burt Reynolds constantly just being surprised. Like before he knows it, he's on his ass.
Yeah.
And he kind of gets up and he's like, and he picks up like a metal kind of thing. And he's like, if you hit me with that, I'm going to be very upset. And he's like, and he kind of goes to, he still does it. And of course it doesn't work out for him. It's great. And then the same thing kind of happens with Clint Walker, who is like, you watch Deliverance and you think Burt Reynolds, because Burt Reynolds is kind of like the actual sporty, tall, kind of muscular guy, longest yard, all that kind of stuff. In Mystery Alaska, he towers over everyone else in that film. Compared to Clint Walker, he looks like a little kid. It's and Ossie Davis.
You know, without a shirt on, he looks like he's covered in pelts, if you want to talk about the Wild West.
Yeah.
I've not seen this film.
It is great, and it also, it's filled with a kind of a cast of great character actors, like William Shalit and Woodrow Palfrey, and my favorite, Anthony James, who's usually, I don't want to spoil anything for anyone, but he's the diner, I think he's the guy who works in the diner in The Heat of the Night.
All right, I don't remember that.
You know,
I remember the film, but I don't remember the guy.
Very surprisingly entertaining. And, hopefully I can convince someone to release it on Blu-ray locally. That'd or DVD, because I don't know if it's actually had a local DVD release.
Well, that'd be amazing.
But it's definitely worth checking out. It's probably on, I think it's on a streaming platform locally. I think in my head, and I could be wrong, it was one of those Warner... on demand, the Warner Archive releases that brought it out. So if it's Warner, then there's a fat chance that it will be available locally, because Warner suck it when it comes to releasing the majority of things from their catalogue.
Good Movie Monday is made possible with the support of people like Viewlorium. Viewlorium is a streaming platform for rare and obscure movies, and it's absolutely free. They also have a catalogue full of kids' flicks, classic movies, foreign cinema, and more. Visit Viewlorium.com today to see what it's all about.
So I'm gonna clock my second recommendation up as a quick nod. I'm not going to really spend a lot of time on this one, just to keep the show running, people don't want to hear me go on and on and on.
Don't they?
No.
Oh.
The whole reason that the show was... to hear you go on and on
and rambling.
Well, they've made a horrible mistake.
Might be because I've lost my bearings.
The truth comes out. He can't handle his whiskey.
We all know. We all know what happened last time I drank on the show. Either I make it a weekly thing or I don't do it at all.
Yeah, do I need to check the recording before it comes out this week?
No. Send us a preview.
What's the length of it? Yeah, that seems a bit short. I think you might be missing something there. Am I the bad influence? Maybe I'm the bad influence.
So the old Overlander, you know, meat pie western thing got me really in the mood for Aussie westerns this week. So my second one is another one. One that I think is a banger. It's, you'll know what it is straight away. Based on the Banjo Patterson poem of the same name, The Man from Snowy River. I'm going to just throw out number one and two as one recommendation, 1982 and 1988. It's pure melodrama. Like, it is, you know, really, really sort of soap opera-ish, but a lot of heart, a lot of substance, and, like, banger soundtrack. The score for it is iconic. The imagery from it's iconic. All shot in Victoria's high country, all about a young countryman who captures and tames wild brumbies and falls in love with a rancher's daughter. But Kirk Douglas was in the first one in two roles. He played the twin brothers. One was a disheveled prospector, and the other one was the wealthy American rancher.
Like Lee Marvin in Cat Ballou.
Yeah, well, I reckon that was a throwback, to be honest with you. And then Brian Dennehy replaces him in part two, which it's the strangest recasting ever. Like, two guys have never looked more unalike.
But I will not stand here and listen to anyone badmouth anything that Brian Dennehy
has been because doing. He's still good in it. He just has a different...
Totally different.
He has a very imposing figure, but he's not like the asshole that Kirk Douglas was.
And he also looks like he ate Kirk Douglas as a snack.
Yeah, that's right. That's where the difference comes in. Like, you got from skinny to really bulky.
I mean, I love tough guys, but if Brian Dennehy was the guy they were going up against, like Charlton Heston maybe had a chance, Kirk Douglas, no. I don't care how fit
he is. That's a movie I revisited recently, and that did not age well, like socially speaking.
No.
But anyway,
Well, if ageism is a thing, then it does okay, but otherwise... No,
but The Man from Snowy River, I reckon it deserves a revisit. I think it's one of the great Australian films, you know. I like the sequel, but the first one is...
I like the TV series too.
That's the thing. It did spawn, not only that, an arena spectacular. Like, amazing. But I don't know what it is about it. The Disney released part two in America as Return to Snowy River, so a lot of people over there that are listening might know that. A lot of people over there know part two, but not part one, so...
Yeah, right.
Mm. Yeah.
But it also made Tom Berlinson a star.
Well, I should talk about that.
Yeah. And it allowed him to make Time Guardian, for which I'm eternally grateful.
Tom Berlinson, Sigrid Thornton. I think Sigrid Thornton was already sort of a pretty household name.
Like Snapshot and stuff.
Yeah, that's right.
She'd done Sea Change by the time.
And of course, and when all else fails, get Jack Thompson in there, you know.
Yeah.
Can't go wrong. Kind
of, well, it's almost a rule, not quite.
Yeah.
But that you can't make an Australian film without Jack Thompson.
Yeah.
Somewhere. That's right. It's almost a rule.
But I do love The Man from Snow River. One interesting thing, if you're a tourist of any kind, even a local tourist, the hut that they shot it on up in the Alpine region is still there. Although it did burn down in the bushfires 10 years ago and they rebuilt it.
Mm.
It's not the same when they rebuilt it, is it?
It's not.
But you can go and visit where they filmed and it still looks the same as it did in the film.
He's just lucky that it didn't fall onto, what was his name, Stuart Diver.
Oh.
Because the Alpine... Yeah. Where was it?
Different Alpine regions. Completely. We're not talking snow slopes here, we're just talking Alpine region. Anyway, Man from Snow River, I've said it like 5 times now. Mousy, over to you.
Over to me.
What was the name of the film again, Glenn, sorry?
Actually, you know what, Mousy, before we do, let's talk about some horror westerns. I promised that at the start of the show.
Let's do it.
Let's talk about some good ones. So, Bone Tomahawk's a recent one. The Double Spot, Sonier production.
Production, yeah, with Kurt. I think that was the movie that Kurt Russell actually grew his beard for,
and
which has now become like a trademark.
Because he had just come off it when he did Hateful Eight, and Tarantino was like, keep it.
Yeah.
Keep that beard.
Yeah.
That's right. Ravenous is one you love, Ben?
I do love it, and that is like the straight version of Cannibal the Musical.
Yeah.
Even though it's not so straight.
But. I found a really interesting one called Mohawk on Shudder, which is sort of a recent one that released.
That's Ted Gehagen's.
Yeah,
movie.
Yeah.
The guy who wrote We Are in, what's that? The house one with Barbara Crampton and We Are Still Here. We Are in the
House.
Yeah, We Are Still Here. Something like that.
I started watching it the other night. I got maybe half an hour into it and I got sleepy for just being exhausted. And I'm going to come back to it because it was quite good.
Yeah.
Should I dare say From Dusk Till Dawn 3 and Tremors 4 because
they are
westerns and I like them a lot. An Aussie one would be In of the Damned.
Yes, near the Dan.
Banger, there's lots of boobs in that one.
And there's things like Ghost Riders.
Yep.
And Sundown, the town that...
Town that dreaded Sundown.
Dreaded Sundown. What's the one with Bruce Campbell, where is the vampire? He goes to the town and all the vampires are wearing sunscreen and stuff. That's a Western.
It is. It is.
Can't think of that. Well, he was in Dust to Dawn 2 as well, so that's a vampire one.
Yeah.
Oh, God, what is it? It's on the tip of my
head. And good friend Albert Pune in 2007 made one called Left 4 Dead, which was a horror Western, which is...
Over there? Yeah. over yonder?
And arguably, like, it's not on the surface, it doesn't look like a horror, but I would almost class High Plains Drifter with Clint Eastwood as a horror, because it's been argued by a lot of historians, like cinematic historians, that he's undead. He's, like, mm-hmm. not a human
he's
character.
He's a vengeful spirit.
Yeah,
that's exactly. why he paints the town red.
Well, yeah, but in the film, it's sort of, it's very sort of, it's not actually implied that way. It's sort of, it's left to you to sort of talk about afterwards and come to that conclusion. Anyway, there we go. Wanted to get the horror stuff in because you're on the show.
I was going
to
say, what about the greatest, and it's not really a movie, but it almost is, but Undead Red Revolver, the game. Have you guys played this?
No.
I know it. I haven't played it.
I know it, yeah.
It is terrifying. Like, yeah. It's like the first time I played Silent Hill, and I played it like at midnight and the house was silent, no lights on except for the TV, and that movie, the game freaked me the fuck out. Undead Red Revolver did the same thing.
Yeah.
Like you start off and it's to a degree, it's like playing Resident Evil.
Yeah.
Where you start off with, you've got the gun, but you've got like three bullets and you blow those immediately and then you're just fucked for the rest of the game.
Yeah, right.
And this one, you've got like a six shooter. You shoot the zombies. Of course, it doesn't... Like, you're riding around on a horse as fast as you can because they're tearing you apart. Everything's on fire. It's the dead of night. The zombies are everywhere. It is...
The only thing I know about those games is they've got cool covers.
So, I really want to play video games. Like, just randomly. Really feel like I love it, but I'm kind of stuck back in the Nintendo days where I fucking clocked the Flintstones game. It's the Jetsons level at the end, and I clocked that. And so I must have been kind of okay back then, but I really, really want to. But I'm now taking my son, my nearly 4-year-old son, to Time Zone, and he beats me on nearly everything.
Well, I mean,
but I fucking love it. But we're not getting that many points up because I'm really shit.
You're showing your age because, like, you want a game with a cartridge like I do. Like, that's, you know, that's your
era.
Have
you played, like, House of the Dead?
No, I haven't played. No, I haven't played any. And Adam, who is one of the co-organisers of the Melbourne Horror Film Society, he did invite me over. He was like, if you want to come and play the Evil Dead game... Because they're starting to realise how much I really want to, but I think I'm really shit. But I'm very excited about it.
Still, games night at my place in my lounge.
Yeah.
I mean, being shit at those games is a rite of passage. Like, it's only something that you can do when you're older. Like, I play Fortnite a lot now, and it is amazing how quickly I get killed by the 12-year-olds.
Well, look, Malzy, like, I never...
Not the 4-year-olds, but the 12-year-olds. No, I've still got a little way to go, but yeah.
Well, the 4-year-olds are just... They spend a lot of time just doing the dance moves and stuff.
Yeah.
And getting the grey guns. They're just happy to be there. Yeah. But the 12-year-olds are, like they're on a mission, and they're quite rude on the chat.
Oh.
When they detect that you're...
an old man.
Well, that'd get me angry.
Yeah, over the age of 15.
I never got beyond the 64, Nintendo 64, and I have to cover PAX later in the year, so wish me luck for that.
Well, I never even got up to the 64. I was just on the... I was on the original Nintendo.
That too.
So,
that's my preference. Yeah. All right, your final recommendation.
Okay, so back to my final recommendation. So after that whole segue into horror westerns, I'm actually not even doing a horror. But I was lent a DVD many years ago by a friend that I did my master's with and also comes to the Horror Society, and she lent me a DVD, and it, unsurprisingly, has sat in my cupboard all of these years.
Never give it back.
And when and it's been sitting there like over my shoulder going, you never watch anything, you should watch me. And so when this came up, I'm just like, oh, I don't know what I'll do. Oh, I fucking need to do that DVD that's been sitting in my... So finally, last night, I got around to it. And, you know, it's a classic. And she'd told me how amazing it is. And everyone is absolutely right. So it's 1996's Lone Star.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
John Sayles, yeah?
John Sayles. This movie was ruined for me by Luan. If you're listening, Luan... this is, I mean, I know that maybe I ruined TV shows for people, but they're TV shows. You can't really ruin the Late Show sketch. You can't ruin. And he told me the twist, and it ruined the movie. And it's still, every time I go to revisit, I'm like, now I know that. I still know the twist.
Two weeks in a row, John Sayles is getting a bit of a run for his money on this show.
So it's a neo-Western, so it has a contemporary setting. And oh my God, I loved it so much. It has an amazing cast. So Chris Cooper, so American Beauty that we mentioned earlier. he's the main guy. He plays the current sheriff of a small border town in Texas. It's got Elizabeth Peña. Matthew McConaughey plays Chris Cooper's dad in flashbacks. Chris Christopherson plays a deplorable former town sheriff, also in the flashbacks. A young Chandra Wilson. Frances McDormand makes a pretty funny appearance as Chris Cooper's ex. And you pretty much know all the faces that appear in it from various things. The film has a mystery, which
Ben knows all about.
We won't spoil for you.
Well, not so much the mystery. That wasn't what he ruined.
That's true. It's that's the other... actually not the main.
The other twist.
So interesting note, though.
Which don't even spoil after we're off the mic, because I've seen the film a few times, but you can't remember. That's
I love that. That's me all the time, which is kind of sucks, because I am like, yeah, I know I've seen that, but I can't remember anything. But I can like rewatch stuff and be like,
It'll click before I get there. It'll click before I get there.
Funnily enough, it's the only thing I remember about the film.
Yeah.
Just that one twist.
Because you were so angry about it.
I was so upset by it. Because I loved John Sayles, because I was a big fan of Matewan. I really loved Passion Fish.
Yep.
And what was the other one that he did around that time? I can't remember the name of it. But Limbo I loved as well.
Oh, that's my favorite.
You know, like all those Brother from Another Planet, was that his one? He did one of those ones.
Going right back to Piranha Secaucus and Howling, 7
and
Alligator.
Yeah. I'm just the ones he directed, though. But yeah.
Okay, so <Are we
done>? You're done, Ben.
Do you want to take over?
All I wanted to do was derail Glenn's, but it was so short. I just had all the derailing in me. I had to get it out somewhere.
Fair enough.
I shot the derailment all over you. I'm sorry.
I'm misfired. Yeah. Okay, so it starts out with two people searching for old bullet casings in an old shooting range, and they discover a human skull along with a Rio Sheriff's badge in the desert. They call Chris Cooper out to, you know, have a look. There's a lot of race stuff in it, so Texas and Mexican history and current dynamics between the cultures. A lot of family stuff, children trying to live up to their parents, a lot of pressure. And something kind of random that stands out is how amazing the transitions are between the current time and the flashbacks. Like the camera will pan and then seamlessly go into, like, you know, back in time or forward. And, it's really quite captivating. The story's so rich, there are quite a lot of narratives, as we've said, like you've got twists and other twists and twists and...
stories within stories.
So
A, B, C and D subplots.
Yep. So there's quite a lot of narratives going on, and they all end up fitting perfectly together to tell the full story and for so many arcs to come full circle.
So what happens in the end?
Amazing. Which twist would you like me to give away? No, it's
when I'm this drunk, it's always a nipple twist.
I'm so glad.
They've dug up the JFK's body. That's what it is.
What came to mind.
It's the man who killed JFK.
I'm so glad after all of these years that I finally had the push to finally watch it, because it was awesome.
Well, I mean, I'm glad somebody picked a neo-Western. For sure.
Yeah.
So that's it? It's your recommendation?
That's my recommendation. Oh, no, actually, no, it wasn't. There's another one.
You're just joking, mate.
Yeah, I'm just joking.
Yeah.
Just
I just never know when I'm
going to talk about The Borrowers.
Well, we're pretty much almost at the end of the show, so this is where we do that little bit of pointless trivia.
I can't wait for this
that
one.
You two fucking love.
I'm usually so bad at the horror ones.
That's it. In keeping in line with today's theme, we're going to do Western trivia. So I'll go first and fire one off at you. So, are you ready?
Certainly.
Before making Django Unchained, Quentin Tarantino made a cameo in which previous Django movie?
Sukiyaki Western Django.
Yes.
Sukiyaki Western.
Which is the Takashi Miike or Miike film.
I saw that at MIFF and I was bored to tears.
It's not great.
Oh, really?
Tarantino is fucking atrocious.
Oh, really?
If you thought he was bad at the end of his Django.
Yeah.
He was pretty bad in this one.
Yeah, right.
I like the style of this, but it's definitely style over substance. It's it's a pretty nothing film.
I mean, Takeshi Miike is hit and miss.
He is. And that's because, I mean,
he does make 200 films a year.
I was about to say, he's prolific in the output, but you've got to have a lot of, like, your misses are going to be pretty bad.
Yeah.
But a bit of extra trivia for you there is that there have been 25 Django movies in total.
Mm.
And there a lot of them aren't even Django movies.
No.
Like, there's not even a character called Django. I think
officially there's three Django, actual Django movies. That
there you go. Take that to the water cooler tomorrow.
Does that include Tarantino's?
Getting fucking sledged from my drinking buddy here.
No, I liked it.
Oh, did you?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, well.
I think you should. I mean, I think people should.
Good. So do I.
Yeah.
Ben, go. I can't take an insult from a compliment at the moment.
Too drunk. I was going to tie my question into...
Marion.
Into Sam Whiskey. Yeah. No, okay. Into Sam Whiskey. But I'll take it easy. I'm going to take it easy on you guys. So James Garner.
How patronising.
I'll still have no clue, but
thank you.
James Garner starred in the TV series Maverick. And he also starred in the reboot movie with Mel Gibson. Name any three other cast members in Maverick, the movie.
Okay, so...
I don't know.
And we can't do Mel Gibson.
You can't do Mel Gibson.
Okay, Renee Russo.
No.
What, we can't do Renee Russo? She's not in
She's not in it.
Isn't she?
No.
Could have sworn she was in it.
No, you've already failed.
I'd rather you make them really difficult so I didn't look so dumb that I don't know obvious ones.
I've got the poster in my fucking head. Who's sitting with him?
It's Jodie Foster.
Jodie Foster. Renee Russell would have been better.
It would have been great in it. Yeah. Jodie Foster is pretty good.
And Richard Donner's cousin would have been in there. He's got to be in the film. He's the chief from Lethal Weapon. And he's in Warlock 2. He plays one of the druids.
Maybe.
He's in every Richard Donner film from a certain point onwards.
Yeah. He's not one of the... Like, at the end with the gamblers, there's a lot of famous faces.
So let's just say that's a yes.
I mean, there's some
And the chick that plays the psychiatrist or psychologist from Lethal Weapon, she's got to be in there. She was the mum from the Goonies.
Look, I don't think so. I think they'd already
been... The person that was from that, they've got to be in there.
I think they'd already divorced.
I'm just going for the Richard Donner staples here.
That was James Coburn.
Yes.
There's...
I've got to admit, I don't like Maverick.
Really?
Neither the TV show or the movie.
I can't remember his name. I can always have trouble thinking of his name. But who's the guy who played Dr. Octopus?
Alfred Molina.
Alfred Molina is Angel, one of the bad guys in it. Who else pops up in there? Uncle Jesse from The Dukes of Hazzard turns up.
Oh, not from Full House.
Not from Full House, no. but I said James Coburn, didn't I? He's one of the main ones. Graham Greene.
Oh, of course.
Turns up. Paul Smith from Pieces is in it.
Yeah.
And don't you know that, Melzy?
No. I don't know Melzy.
He's great. He's like, he plays like a... I hope it's him. I don't want to be proved wrong.
No,
on the internet.
I think it is him.
He plays a rich Russian who wants to dangerous game style kill an Indian, but he doesn't want to take any actual risks. So Maverick pretends to be dresses up as an Indian.
Just for you, I'm going to revisit Maverick.
I really like it. I think it's a great film.
I don't know. Never like that. There's a short period of time where Richard Donner films didn't do anything for me.
See, the thing is, I never thought of it as a Richard Donner film.
Yeah,
it was just like, because I love Maverick the TV series.
I think when it came out, I was obsessed with directors. So to me, everything was associated with who made it. And back then, he did like The Assassin and fucking Conspiracy Theory came after that, and I just wasn't into all that.
Yeah, I remember liking Conspiracy Theory, but not liking it enough to ever watch it again. Like, it was just like, oh, Patrick Stewart's the bad guy. Okay, he's got a broken nose.
All right.
Never need to see this again.
Mousy.
Which movie did John Wayne win an acting Oscar for?
Ooh. The Searchers?
No.
She Wore a Yellow Ribbon?
Hondo.
Nope.
Hang on. It's the one
that was redone.
Yeah,
that was remade.
True Grit.
Yeah, I knew you were onto it as soon as you went, oh, hang on. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, it's the one with, Rooster Cogburn is the sequel to it.
That's that's a remake that's better than the original.
It's a great remake.
Yeah.
Mm. The original's pretty good.
It is good. I just like it.
She's got two. But I remember seeing the remake and going, there's no way that the the young character is called LaBeouf.
Yeah, it totally is.
LaBeouf! Like Matt Damon character.
All right, so Paul Newman and Robert Redford played Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Which actors played their roles in Butch and Sundance the early years, which was the prequel story?
And they look real. Is Daniel Roebuck one of them?
No.
They look really alike. They actually really work.
I reckon, we haven't probably got the time, but if you were to sort of sit there and brainstorm in your own mind for a minute, you'd probably come up with these two.
Yeah. I've got the poster in my head, but I couldn't tell you.
No idea.
Tom Berenger played Butch and William Catt played Sundance.
That's not who I'm thinking of.
I attempted to watch that last week in preparation for the show, and it's bad. It's that bad.
Is it?
This is the kind of shit I love.
Is there a TV series?
Well, it was a made-for-TV movie. I don't think it was even like a pilot sort of window into a show. I think it was just a made-for-TV movie that screened for 90 minutes on a Saturday night or something like that. Anyway, there we go. So Ben, you're up next.
I didn't realize, Sam Shepard played him in Blackthorn.
All right.
That was an aging Butch Cassidy. How can he be aging when they both died? I mean,
spoil that. It's the Young Guns 2 thing again, fucking brushy Bob comes out of nowhere and tells another story.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's another one where it's someone else where, this is not the one I was thinking of.
There was a High Noon 2, which I think Robert Ehrlich played the Gary Cooper character. Anyway, your turn.
All right. This is great.
Love it. This is fantastic.
I love this question. That only
I hate it already. I hate it.
Richard Boone. This is a Richard Boone question. Richard Boone has played a series of bad guys in Amazing Westerns, including Big Jake with John Wayne and Hombre with Paul Newman. But he got famous for playing this in a Western TV series, and I want the name of the Western TV series.
And the five main characters.
It's most famous for its awsome theme song, which was called Paladin. The theme song was Paladin.
This is what I also discovered prepping for the shows. There were so many Western TV shows back in the day.
Bonanza.
No.
I have no idea. I can't even put his face in my head right now.
Richard Boone. No. He's also in the Nightcomers.
The name's not coming to me and the face is not coming to me. I'm sure I would know who he is, but no.
I know the name, but...
It's Have Gun Will Travel.
God damn it.
Can't believe I didn't get that. Fuck.
It was right there.
If you just gave me like 20 seconds extra.
You guys knew this was going to be... like about Westerns, right? I thought you would have watched a couple of them.
You've got to play to our strengths, Ben.
Yeah, sorry. I should ask. Well, I thought the Maverick question was the easy one.
I know.
At least that's a modern one.
This be, what is... No, name a Western.
My other question was going to be Clint Walker, star of Sam Whiskey, starred as the lead in which Western TV series? What's his Western TV series? You never would have got that either.
No, guaranteed. What was it?
Cheyenne. He's Cheyenne in Cheyenne.
Good.
All right, Melzy.
All right. Which Rat Packer starred in Rio Bravo?
Dean Martin.
See? Look,
that's an easy one.
Easy. Yeah. Easy. Yeah.
And who played his part in the original? The movie that there was a remake of? Well, basically the same story. There's that, like the Howard Hawks and the John Ford version kind of thing or whatever it was.
It wasn't the same title though, was it?
It's like Rio Bravo, Rio Lobo, and yeah.
But I thought Howard Hawks made all those together. Like he made all those.
Yeah,
yeah.
But there's one. But in that one, it's John Wayne, Dean Martin, and Ricky Nelson. And then in the other one, it's James Caan is the young kid, the Ricky Nelson part, and John Wayne.
Okay.
Angie Dickinson is the love interest in one of them, and the other guy is. Anyone?
Okay, no. I think we can officially announce
Robert Mitchum
deserves a free water at the next Melbourne Horror Film Society fucking screening because he definitely won the friggin' Western trivia, all right?
I think I only got one of them. And you let me have the second one. You knew it.
I guess that's our cue to mosey on out of here. Yeah.
Partner. Partner.
It's been a fun show. Thanks for being here, Mel. Or should I say little lady?
I love that little lady.
I think another round of drinks is in order.
Why not?
No shilly-shallying, no dilly-dallying.
Next round's on you, Ben.
But now, yep.
Actually, no, the Milky Bars are on
the
you.
The Milky Bars are on me.
Are on you.
On my person.
Lick them off.
In this hot room, they've got a bit melty. So get those tongues ready.
Oh, shit. Thank you to the other guys, Jarrett, Guillermo, the Boneheads, Joe Chad, and James. And thanks to everybody for listening.
They should rename this in the honor of this.
Yep.
They should be the Kentuckians. It should be the Kentuckians.
Yes. That
should be the name of the show.
Boneheads, you should rename your show.
The Kentuckians podcast.
With the intro and outro gunshots. No? Okay. Thank you for listening, everybody. Our sign-off song this week is a Ben favorite, I Want to Be a Cowboy by Boys Don't Cry. And yeah, we'll see you all on the social medias.
You could be my cowgirl, Glenn. Any day of the week.